Good evening, across Americas and around the world. You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, in the earlier hour, which airs at 5 p.m. Pacific, 6 Mountain, 7 Central, and 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we gave the hour over to Tom Donahue so that those of you who missed him on shortwave would understand why he's not there anymore. After the show, several people called me both here and at home to chastise me and tell me that I shouldn't have done that because Tom Donahue has called me a liar and a fraud on his radio show. And we're still getting those calls at home. And I want to tell you to stop. You see, that doesn't matter to me. I believe that Tom Donahue is trying his best to do what he believes is right. He has people like Bobo Gritz whispering in his ear. And, of course, Lars Hansen and several others who have no love for William Cooper or the Hour of the Time because we have exposed them. The truth always prevails, ladies and gentlemen, and ultimately Tom Donahue will realize his mistake. I did the right thing. He needed help. I gave him an hour of my airtime. And when I go to meet my maker, that's all that counts to me. Don't go away. Someone is on the other end of this phone line who will keep you riveted in your seat. But I want to warn you beforehand, we have not been able to verify much of the story that he's going to tell. So as always, you must not believe anything that you hear here or on any other talk show or on the 6 o'clock news or from Dan Rather or Ted Koppel, and especially from Mr. Clinton and his wife, the President, Hillary, or, for that matter, even your own mother. Don't go away, folks. I'll be right back.
Long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep. I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride. But something touched me deep inside today. The music died. So bye, bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. And then good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, "This'll be the day that I die. This will be the day that I die." Did you write the book of love? And do you have faith in God's love? If the Bible tells us so,
You can all get the gist of that. I want to apologize beforehand for my voice. Sometimes I open my mouth and try to say something and nothing comes out and it doesn't sound correct, and I can't project like I normally do, so I have the pot turned all the way up, and that sometimes can create distortion. So please, I beg your forgiveness, and I will try to do what I can on this end to make sure that you can indeed understand me. And Pooh, I want to tell you, I want to thank you for your concern, and your doll is right here with me. Pooh was concerned that I'm ill and was going to work by myself, and she couldn't go, so she sent her doll to be with me instead. That's the kind of family we have, and that's the way we do things together whenever possible. Folks, on the other end of the telephone line, I have Michael Benn, who has been the man in charge of the impeach Clinton campaign, and I understand they have about close to 12 million, if not 12 million signatures already, and I've got some questions to ask him about this. But first, a few things have happened in the last couple of days which are extremely disturbing and indicate that the old philosophers of fire are at work again with their torches, and we're going to get the story right now. I remember before the music, I warned you that we have not verified any of this. Therefore, you have to do the research, you have to check it out yourself. We will be investigating, and we will let you know the results of what we find. Until then, let's welcome Michael Benn to the Hour of the Time and get his story.
Hello, Bill.
Hello.
Well, you just want me to start telling this story?
Well, first tell everybody who you are and what you've been doing, because that certainly has a lot to do with what happened, I think.
Well, it sure does. I'm Michael Benn, and I'm the initiator of the Impeach Clinton campaign, 1993, that really got off the ground last May, 1993. And we've been gathering millions of signatures nationwide. It only took us 45 days to get into all 50 states and get several thousand people involved with us. And then now we have over well over 125,000 people that are out avidly working hard to get other people involved and Xerox copying the petition and getting signatures. We have over 35,000 retail stores, small retail stores nationwide, that have made the commitment to put the petition on the counters of their stores. I'm talking about like shoe stores, auto mechanics, radiator shops, gun stores, dry cleaning establishments, these type of stores that are privately owned. And I think that's a major commitment to put an Impeach Clinton campaign petition out on the counter of your business, you know.
Well, who are you, Michael? What do you do?
Well, before I started this, and for 25 years before that, I've been a specialist in designing neon and electric signs for shopping centers and malls and corporations and things like that, drawing the blueprints and designing logos and everything.
Uh-huh.
And it just hit me real bad when Clinton took office and wanted to sign gays into the military by a presidential order. It really struck me that that was an illegal act. And, of course, after studying it out, we found out that that is an illegal act. It's an act of not only a dictator, but it's an act of someone that's running a parliamentary democracy. And, of course, as time went on, we found out that in his own writings, he thinks of our government as a parliamentary democracy, and it is not a parliamentary democracy. They've stuck this word democracy down our throat for so many years, we think we're in a democracy, but we should really be in a republic. But our government is running a long distance away from being a republic.
Democracy simply means socialism. You can call it anything you want to. You can make up all these fancy-sounding terms, parliamentary democracy, anything you want. It boils down to pure and simple socialism.
Well, that's right. Yeah, and now they call it economic democracy. You know, anything to keep from calling it the S word.
Yeah. Michael, let me ask you something. We heard about you a long time ago, and I have an extensive organization that stretches all the way around the world, and it's an intelligence gathering organization. And we heard about what you were doing, and the reason that we haven't contacted you before now is simply this. We looked into the law and into the Constitution to find out if what you're doing could be done, and we found out absolutely it cannot be done unless you meet certain requirements. The president cannot be impeached unless you can prove, not make allegations, but prove that he has committed high crimes and misdemeanors or has aided or abetted an enemy of the United States of America, which is treason. So gathering signatures to impeach Bill Clinton won't work unless you actually have proof that he has committed high crimes or misdemeanors. Do you have any of this?
That's very true. And what we discovered after looking into this way back, and when we started way back in February of 1993, that we started off then with the misdemeanor charges.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, of course, you probably realize the word misdemeanor in the Constitution doesn't mean, like in criminal law, something less than a felony.
Right.
You know, misdemeanor in the Constitution means a man or woman's demeanor, their personality. What kind of reputation do they have? Are they a person that has a reputation of being a liar, or do they have a reputation of being an upstanding person? And I think it's brilliant that the framers of our Constitution wrote this word misdemeanor in there. Because what when you read the Federalist Papers, you realize the reason they did that is because they realized sometime in the future there'd be men come along that would seek office under false pretenses and lie to get in there. And boy, if anybody fits that category, it certainly is Clinton.
Well, let me ask you something, Michael. Even if you could prove that, which very easy to do, the man's lied about everything he's ever opened his mouth to say.
Right.
But even if you could prove that, what makes you think that any other politicians would support a move to impeach Clinton when they're all like that? Every one of them are liars.
Oh, see, this is the problem, Bill. Our government has gone so far, you know. First of all, this is a right that we should have been using long before 217 years down the road.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you see, but now, here's how we do it. We do it through Article 1 of the Constitution, which says the people will have the right to petition their government with redress of grievance. Now, that's the way we're getting into the government with this. In other words, the petition, our redress of grievance here is is that we want the President of the United States impeached for given reasons.
Uh-huh.
Now, our given reasons multiply daily. Give you an example. There is a trial that hardly anyone is talking about down in the 8th District Court of Appeals now. That's where it's at right now. It's on its way to the Supreme Court. But as of November 16th, it was still in the 8th District Federal Court of Appeals in St. Louis, Missouri. A man named Mace brought the charges. The name of the case is Mace versus Blunt. Now, Blunt used to be the state attorney general for Missouri.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened is that Clinton and the Democratic Party entered into the case as what they call interveners, because the way Mace was suing Blunt, it drew Clinton and the Democratic Party into it. Now, what Mace originally started doing was suing the state attorney general of Missouri for allowing Clinton to run as a presidential candidate in the state of Missouri when he was a treasonous president, and that it could be proven in a court of law, which would make him unqualified to hold office.
Uh-huh.
Now, the case went on and on to where Clinton got involved in it, and then after Clinton got sworn in as president, he got the Justice Department to defend him and fire his own attorneys that he was paying. And this right there is a violation of law, because a public official cannot use the Justice Department to defend them in a personal case. And this is a personal case that Mace has brought against Clinton.
Uh-huh.
And that's an impeachable charge right there. And now the 8th District Court of Appeals would not rule on the evidence in front of them. And the evidence is so compelling, they can't dismiss the case.
You know, of course, that Clinton is a communist.
Of course. And that's what's the evidence that's put into the court, see, and that he is absolutely unqualified to hold office in a constitutional republic government. Now, the court finally ruled on December 29th, because Mace filed what they call a petition for relevance or emancipate. He filed that on November 16th, because they just kept dragging this out and dragging it out, and finally, with that filing, that is such a prejudiced far-out filing that the five justices of that court came back into session on the 29th of December and ruled that, yes, Mace, you have been damaged, and so we're going to allow this to go into the Supreme Court. In other words, instead of ruling on the evidence, they ruled that Mace had been damaged because the court had not ruled on the evidence.
Uh-huh.
And so now it automatically goes to the Supreme Court. And the way I understand it, the Supreme Court has to hear it now. But I think what we're about to find out is if the Supreme Court is ruled by the New World Order or not. I mean, this is going to be the absolute final test to see what our Supreme Court is going to do.
Let me tell you what I think. We have done a study within the ranks of CAGI, Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, and our findings are that Clinton will resign before the end of this term.
Well, good. Then that means all the pressure that everybody's putting on him is working. But you see, it's more than that. We've got to keep this process going, and we've got to get all these characters out of our government that want to take us into this socialism and into this one world order.
Well, you see the problems with this. You can impeach Clinton, and who's going to take his place?
Another Clinton.
Huggetree Gore.
Huggetree Gore, yeah.
And he's worse than Clinton, believe it or not. The reason nobody knows he's worse than Clinton is because he doesn't talk all that much. Clinton's out in front.
That's right.
But if you read his book, if you listen to him, if you go back and read the speeches that he's made in the past, you'll find that this man is one of the biggest haters of Christians that's ever walked on this earth, in his own words. He would blame all of the ills of the world on Christians alone, period. And many, many other things. He was down in the summit in Brazil with Whoopi Goldberg and John Denver and the Dalai Lama. And who was that? Oh, yeah, it was Al Gore. I looked, and they're there to protest the destruction of the rainforest and the pollution of the atmosphere and the destruction of the ozone layer. Here they have this dios made for gods out of probably took 200 trees to make this thing. It's way up high, and then there's these thousands of people all looking at this, sitting on this dais where Al Gore, the Dalai Lama, Whoopi Goldberg, and John Denver, dictating to the world what they should put in this treaty in order to give one central government control of all the natural resources of the world. I sat and watched that, and I just wondered just how insane can we be? We get rid of Clinton, and Gore goes in. You get rid of Gore, who's next?
Well, you know, somewhere down the line, this government is going to have to realize that the rising tide of people getting together and willing to sign petitions and willing to stand up on a local level and start running now for government. I mean, we have constitutional groups right here in Dallas that have got 1,400 people together over a month ago now to fill out the paperwork to run for public office in the state of Texas for the election that's coming up this November.
Uh-huh.
And that's got them alarmed down there in Austin. I got news for you. This need to rise up and take our government back at the local level, city, county, state, and then Washington, D.C. It has to be done.
You know, you're telling that story. I could just see Ann Richards standing there looking out the window with a glass of scotch in her hand, wondering if she's going to have any future. This is, I love that. I love it when people decide to act and get involved and especially run for office.
Right.
Now, Michael, have you come under, before the recent events, and I don't want to get into the recent events until after the break, but before these recent events, were you aware that you were under scrutiny from any source?
Well, not really. The closest we really thought we were under any kind of scrutiny at all, and we never thought of it as a problem, is the Secret Service visited us here about 4 months ago, here at our home, and wanted to talk with me, and I thought that was fine, but, you know, don't stand out on the porch. Come on in. We'll sit down in the dining room. And I had to convince them that that was all right, you know, and my main purpose for doing that is I wanted to show them that we're normal people, middle-class people, is just upset with our government, and we're taking legal, constitutional action to do something about it.
Uh-huh.
You know, we're not white supremacists. We're not any of these things. We're just normal people.
Yeah, you're not circulating a petition to assassinate Clinton. You're circulating a petition legally to impeach Clinton.
But that's why they were here, to ask us those questions. Was our plan to assassinate the president? Was our plan to overthrow the government? Okay, well, that's good. Come to the door and ask me that, and I'll, you know.
Well, they already knew the answer to that. I'll tell you exactly why they were there, Michael. They knew the answer to all those questions. They were there to scare you, to intimidate you. Most people, if they had a visit from the Secret Service asking them those kinds of questions, would stop everything. And you didn't. Why not?
Why not? Because we weren't intimidated by it, you know.
Good for you.
Invited them in, and I said, you know, you need to understand that we don't think you're the enemy, but we think you're working for the enemy. You know, you know, not everybody in government is the enemy. They have jobs. They're making a living, you know.
Well, you're very kind. I don't believe that myself. I believe that if somebody's working for a system that they know is treasonous, that they know is not working according to the law, that they know is working under the color of law, that they know has literally shredded the Constitution and flushed it down the toilet, to me, they are the enemy. I don't care how much they profess their innocence or they're just taking orders. You know, we heard all that from the Nazis in World War II.
Well, yeah, Bill, you're right. If they know that much, but you got to understand something. Carol and I, back in January and February of 1993, did not realize that this country had filed bankruptcy in 1933, did not realize that they're not running constitutional. You know, we've been raised from childhood to believe that we're in a free country, we're free to do what we want, and our government is there to help us, you know? And millions of people are still under that impression.
But yeah, you're right. But these people are outside the government. The people are in the government, working in the government, accomplishing these things. They know what they're doing. They're not that stupid. You can't tell me that these police officers who are busting down doors in the middle of the night without search warrants, confiscating people's property unconstitutionally, and then auctioning it off, and not even charging anybody with anything, or nor taking them to court, nor having them convicted of any crime, you can't tell me that they don't realize that they're violating the Constitution.
Well, I think they're absolutely criminal.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and with the way things are taking place in the country right now, and Waco being an open attack of war, I think there needs to be some tribunal courts of war set up to try these people. I really do. And, you know, it happened in France. I don't know how many people listening tonight know the history of France, you know, but they
We better be careful. We don't want to happen here what happened in France.
Well,
because once they started those guillotines going, they didn't care whose head they chopped off. They were chopping off anybody's head they could grab.
Well, that's true. Things like that get out of hand.
You better believe it.
Somehow we have to keep things lawful. But the government is certainly not keeping things lawful. I'll tell you that. They're getting completely out of hand. And after, I guess you want to wait till after the break. But
I think that there is an intentional campaign with malice aforethought to create a total breakdown of the structure of our society and bring us into a state of chaos and anarchy so that they will be justified in bringing about a total brutal dictatorship.
I think you're exactly right. Yeah, and I would have never believed that myself 8 months ago. And fortunately, there's people waking up, though. See, Clinton has been a big wake-up call to millions of people.
Oh, yes.
And listen, we get calls every day here on our recorder saying, thank you very much, Michael. I got your newsletters. I read them. I didn't know things were so bad, but we're going to support you, and we want more newsletters, and we're going to start looking into these things. See, people now by the millions are starting to get educated. It's just not constitutional groups of 10 or 15 people in every major city doing this anymore. It's now millions of people waking up.
Uh-huh.
So that's a step in the right direction.
Great.
And Linda Thompson's waking up a lot of people. Tom Donahue, Valentine, everybody. I mean, it's time. This is a big wake-up call, and it has to happen pretty quick.
Uh-huh.
Somebody's got to get out of the bed pretty quick here.
Yep. Well, it's going to disintegrate into some sort of chaotic situation, and I just hope we can come out of it without losing everything in the process. Unfortunately, looking back through history, what you get when you come out of something like this ain't what you started out for when you began it. So everybody has to be careful what they begin. And
hopefully some good men will come to the top, revolution to break away from Britain, you know.
Uh-huh.
I mean, George Washington and the founders of our Constitution had an opportunity, if they were self-serving men, to form another monarchy.
Well, they weren't self-serving. They were serving a higher cause.
They were, and this is the kind of men that we need to come to the top now.
They were serving what they called the Brotherhood of Man, and they had a hidden agenda for creating this country, and that was to give man the first taste of freedom in the history of the world and thus topple the kings and queens from their thrones. And it would prove whether or not man could truly rule himself. And all of them didn't think that we could. And we're proving that their fears were justified, because what's happening, believe it or not, is not the fault of anyone but ourselves. We let it go. We were apathetic. We were ignorant. We were stupid. And we have let it slip out of our grasp. Now, we've got to get smart and get it back.
Well, I think with the knowledge of what's going on, we'll get it back. We've just been duped, you know. Listen, it's easy to believe that, hey, let's turn on the 6 o'clock news and see what's going on in the world.
Yeah.
It's easy to believe that.
Free press, huh?
Yeah, it's so free, nobody knows about the Mace versus Blunt case. That's how free everything is.
Yeah. Okay, why don't you just hang on there? We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about what's happened in the last few days.
Okay.
Folks, you're hearing it here, and you're hearing it straight from the horse's mouth, as usual. What you're hearing does not portend good for our future. We know that things are disintegrating. We know that the dollar is losing its value. We know that our industry is moving to foreign countries. We know that this GATT and NAFTA treaty thing, this scam, is going to eventually eliminate the middle class in the United States of America. And if you go back and read the writings of Karl Marx, you'll see that he propounded free trade to do exactly that, to eliminate what he called the bourgeoisie, so that class wars would then ensue, leading to the establishment of a Marxist, socialist, communist state. What's happening in this country, ladies and gentlemen, is what happened during the 30s when Hitler was rising to power. What's happening in this country is what happened in Russia and in the Eastern Bloc states shortly after and during the Bolshevik Revolution. Now, none of these things happened by accident. And if you trace the money, remember, always follow the money, you'll see that Hitler and the communists in the Bolshevik Revolution were backed by financial interests in New York and London. They're the same people who funnel money to the terrorists around the world. They're the same people who give money to Israel and then to the Arabs. They're the same people who funnel money to Saddam Hussein and then give him the go-ahead to invade a small country called Kuwait and then suck the nations of the world into a Middle East war to establish the foundation in international law that the United Nations, for the first time in history, can pass a resolution and send a police force to enforce it, thus toppling the concept of national, individual, independent nation sovereignty from the law books of the world. We are in the birth pangs of a new world order. We are in the beginning stages of what is going to be a painful birth of a complete change in everything that we understand in the world. And you had better be prepared for it. We recommend that you have 2 years' supply of food stored. I don't care where you get it. We had it offered cheaper than you could get it anywhere in this nation. We guaranteed it. Nobody bought one can of beans. So you have to get it elsewhere, folks. But you need to get it regardless. You need 2 years' supply of water. You need all the things that you won't be able to get if there is a breakdown of the transportation system in this country for a prolonged period of time. You need to protect yourself financially against a total collapse of our economic system. And there's only one class of commodities throughout history that has fulfilled that need, and that's precious metals in its various forms. So call our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, at 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Do it right now. You know you will procrastinate until you forget about it, or you'll put it off until you can rationalize why you shouldn't. But I want you to look around at the faces of your loved ones in your home, and if you cannot, right then and there, show them and prove to them that you have provided for their financial future in case of a total and complete economic collapse, then you must call. You must, because you have no other choice except to admit your family that you're irresponsible and that you really don't love them like you profess. Now, I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not trying to make you out to be a bad guy. I'm just putting it where it really is. That's the truth, folks. So do it. And if you can't satisfy the need at Swiss America Trading, call somebody else, but make sure it's a good, honest, reputable company. The number is 1-800-289-2646. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. You'll be glad that you did. Thank you. Michael, are you still there?
Yes, Bill, here.
Okay, what's that loud noise I hear?
On my end?
I don't know.
No?
It doesn't matter if it stopped. Tell us what has transpired recently within the last few days.
Well, on Tuesday the 11th, which was last Tuesday, at 15 minutes before daylight, 20 minutes, 15 minutes before daylight, we heard military helicopters over our house, and it woke me up and got me out of bed. So I got up and looked out the window, and I saw this white-gray fog real thick rolling in, and I all over the neighborhood, and I really couldn't see past 2 feet out my window, but I could still hear these helicopters, and they sounded very, very low to the house. And then they moved off across the street, and then about like 100 yards down the street, and then they faded off and went away. So I thought, well, maybe the fog is just making the noise echo, and maybe they're not as close as I think. So I just laid back down and went to bed, and of course I looked at the clock, and it was 6:45, and at 6:45 here in Texas, it's still not quite daylight. And so I went back to sleep, and then here I hear fire engines coming down the street. It woke me up again, and I looked at the clock. It's like 1 minute after 7, 2 minutes after 7. And I thought, well, I have to get up and go outside and see what in the world's going on, because there's something really wrong here. Went outside, and by this time it's almost completely daylight, and about 90% of the fog had left by this time.
Was this a natural fog, or was this something else?
I don't think it was a natural fog. Carol and I make a real strict habit of praying over all the mail that comes in here.
Uh-huh.
And standing on Psalms 91, which says that anyone that professes the Lord as his Savior and stands on this word, that their home will be protected from any harm, and along with a bunch of other things that Psalms 91 says. And, we feel like that the government is evil, and we feel like we need to do these things. We pray over the petitions. We lay our hands on them every day as they come in and pray that these people will be protected from the evil that's in this government.
Let me comment on something you said. Our government, Michael, I know what you mean, but a lot of people out there don't know what you mean. Our government is not evil. Our government is the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. What we are currently being called under, what we are being ruled by now, is not our legally constituted constitutional government.
Oh, that's right, and that's the one I mean. You're exactly right. I guess I should start distinguishing that myself. But, I really feel like we had protection here Tuesday morning. We certainly put Psalms 91 to the test. At any rate, I walked out in the street, and a bunch of the neighbors were out there. The fire trucks were now running into the house just 100 yards away from us. The people and the three children were running out with a handful of clothes and crying and screaming. And I asked one of the neighbors, what in the world's going on? They said, we don't know if it's an electrical fire or whatever. And I says, well, gosh, there seems to be a lot of disturbance in the neighborhood this morning. I said, did you hear a bunch of military helicopters that seemed awful low to the ground? And the woman said, yes, I certainly did. And she says, it certainly woke me up. And the man across the street said the same thing. At any rate, I'm not associating these helicopters with the fire, and so it takes them a couple hours to put it out, and everybody's walking back into their house, and I'm going on with the day's activity of getting the mail out to people that have called in to us. And then we begin to notice that within 2 hours, here comes 6, 7, 8 white Chevrolet plain cars, brand new ones, the middle size, guys getting out in suits with cellular phones up to their ear, walking down to that house. Two of them parked across the street from our house and looked over at our house, then walked down to the house that was burnt out. And I told Carol, I says, Carol, this woman must have an awfully good insurance company. Look how many agents they send out here. And they're already out here, and it's just been 2 hours. And then a van drive comes up in front of their house, and they take the TV out of the house and all the electrical appliances and a few chairs and everything, and then that van takes off. And I said, I have never seen an insurance company so quickly help people before in my life, because I'm still not associating this with being Secret Service people and federal agents. And around 6:30 that night, I saw my neighbor across the street at 7-Eleven, and I said, "It's a shame what happened down there." And I said, "Has anybody found out what caused the fire yet?" He said, "Well, at 4:30 in the afternoon, I walked down there, and a bunch of guys in their suits and everything that were in those white cars, telling the fire marshal that the house was hit by lightning." And the fire marshal told me, he said he didn't know what caused the fire because there was no electrical problem or anything. But these guys were insisting that the house was hit by lightning. And he said, I told them, he said, there was no rain this morning, no lightning, no anything. And I says, well, did you hear those helicopters this morning? He says, yes, I sure did. And so a lot of people in the neighborhood are real upset about this because now it's become obvious that this has something to do with the helicopters.
Michael, what kind of a phone do you have?
Kind of a phone?
Yeah. What kind of phone are you using?
It's not a cellular phone.
Well, you're cutting out, but something's going on here.
Really?
Yeah.
Everything seems to be all right on my end.
Okay, just make sure you don't move the cord between your handset and the phone. Sometimes those things can cause a break.
All right, is this better now?
Yeah, just go ahead and continue. If it starts to do it again, I'll stop you.
Okay. Okay, at any rate, it gets to be Wednesday morning, and about 45 minutes after daylight, I decide I need to get up and go down there and see if anybody's down there. Well, there's two guys down there digging stuff out of the attic, taking parts of the roof out, and loading it into an 18-foot flatbed trailer parked out front of the street.
Ah, the evidence.
Yeah.
They must destroy the evidence just like at Waco and everywhere else.
Yeah. So, and then there's a guy standing outside, looks like a construction worker. He drives up in, what are these things that are like a car, but yet it's a Jeep? I think Chrysler makes them. Winnebago or something? I don't know, whatever.
I don't know.
It's like a car Jeep thing. At any rate, it's a lot of construction people use those vehicles, but this one just happened to be new, and I noticed there was no construction tools in the back of it or anything. This guy was trying to look like a construction worker, except he was clean-shaved, hair comb perfect, executive cut.
Now, wait a minute. You're going to make a lot of construction workers angry out there. I know a lot of construction workers that shave and have clean haircuts. And
the point I'm making to you is, as I go on here, his clothes were brand new, his boots were brand new, and he's got a clipboard in his hand. And so I asked him, I says, well, are you with the insurance company or the construction company? Rebuilt the house already? And he says, yeah, we're here to clean it out and rebuild it. And I said, oh. I said, well, did you ever figure out what started this fire? And he says that it was hit by lightning. And I said, well, there was no lightning or rain here Tuesday morning. He says, yeah, this house was hit by lightning. And that's the official ruling. So I started to walk up and walk in the house to look around, and he walked up aggressively towards me and made it clear to me that I was not to go in there. He says, you don't want to go in there. You could get hurt. I said, well, okay, fine.
That's a threat.
Yeah, I know it is. And so I just walked back home, and I told Carol what was going on down there. And we watched the place, and at 10 o'clock, they drove away with the trailer and never came back. And I started calling some friends of mine around Texas here that are helping us with the campaign and everything, and telling them the whole story, and that these helicopters obviously missed our house in the fog or whatever happened here. And because there was no lightning, no rain, or anything. And then, after we get on the phone and start telling people that, at 1 o'clock on Wednesday, here comes two of these black helicopters. One of them comes down, they're on top of each other,
mm-hmm.
and one of them comes clear down so low to our roof that it ripped 27 of the tiles loose and slung them out in the backyard, you know, from the wind, from the helicopter.
Yeah.
And stayed there for like 3 minutes, and our dogs just went crazy in the house. The cats went crazy, and the roof actually shook. And this is a pretty big house. And it was really frightening. And then they went away after about 3 minutes, just pulled off on an angle like they do in the movies, you know, real fast on an angle, and then went away.
Any of your neighbors see this?
Listen, the neighbors at this point don't want to talk to us. They don't want to talk about this.
You know, that really makes me angry. That means they're a bunch of stupid sheeple, and they would watch you murdered in your front yard and wouldn't do a damn thing about it, wouldn't they?
It kind of looks that way, doesn't it?
Boy, I'll tell you, if any of your neighbors are listening, I hope they hear this, because in my estimation, anybody who acts that way is nothing but scum in my book.
Well, I'll tell you, I guess it takes a lot to get people off their duff and start acting.
Not around here. Everybody's militia.
Good. Well, we're starting to get that going here in Texas, too, I'll tell you that.
Good.
And you know, by this time, we call a private investigator that we know, and he couldn't get here till Thursday. And so he came Thursday, and of course, by this time, they're all gone. Nobody's around. The woman that owns the house is not around. We haven't figured out what happened to her until today, which it seems to be all right. They've got her convinced that the house was hit by lightning, and now the real insurance company has showed up today, which is a week later. And real construction people are there today giving her a price on everything.
Uh-huh.
And anyway, on Thursday, the private investigator that we called in that we know personally here in Dallas to come down here and look at the house and see what could be done. I didn't, when I was relating the story to him, I forgot to tell him that they had taken the TV out and everything. So we walked down and looked at the house, and he says, well, it's very obvious that this house was hit in four different places on the roof by something. And lightning does not hit in four different places. And he says, now look up here, Mike, the fireplace coming out of the center of the roof. It has a big TV antenna on it,
mm-hmm.
with two ground wires coming down from it. Now, he said at least one of those ground wires would be burned in half.
Well, this is lightning country here. In fact, aside from Florida, this is the second highest incident state of lightning strikes in the country. And I know that lightning always hits the highest point that's grounded.
That's right.
Which means that it would hit that antenna if it has ground wires going to ground before it hit anything else.
That's exactly right. That's what he said. And he said, now, since the antenna's on the roof and it's got ground wires, what we need to do is get in the house, take the back off the TV. He said, I've got some kind of meter he's got.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, we can stick it on the TV, take the back off, stick it on the TV, and the way the ohms meter reads, that's what it is, an ohms meter. The way the ohms meter will read, it will tell you whether the house has been hit by lightning or not.
Hmm.
And I says, my God, they loaded up the TV and the appliances and hauled them away. He says, you're kidding me. He says, well, man, he says, this is really looking bad now. I said, that's one of the first things they did was bring up a great big van truck and load up the TV and all the electrical appliances and a bunch of chairs and everything like that and left.
Where are all these petitions, Michael?
They're in not all of them are in the house here. We've got over 400, actually closer to 500 groups now nationwide that are not only collecting them, but they're keeping them because they have, you know, thousands of them.
I would suggest that you get whatever petitions you have out of your house surreptitiously, if you know what I mean, and into other hands that you can trust.
Well,
and if I were you, I would arm myself and I would move someplace where I had neighbors that I could trust.
It sure sounds that way, doesn't it?
And I wouldn't even bother to even acknowledge the humanity of the people that are around you if they're treating you that way.
Well, you know, maybe they're just going through this stage where they don't want to believe this or anything, you know. I've been through several stages myself in the last few days. I mean, this is frightening to think that we're supposed to be living in a free country where the government is supposed to protect your rights to live a peaceful life, and the government is coming in to harass you. And not only harass you, but actually shoot missiles at you? Hey, this is getting real serious.
Oh, yes. It's been real serious for a long time. Anyone who didn't understand what happened at Waco and how serious it already is just ain't playing with a full deck of cards, my friend.
Well, I'll tell you what. We in our report number 5 that we just came out with, we got one page in it that's a memorial to the people down there, and it shows two tombstones on the page. And on one of the tombstones, it lists all the children and their ages that were killed. And then on the other tombstone, it lists all the names and ages of the men and women that were killed. And it says, I put on the sheet of paper that you will not be forgotten.
Uh-huh.
And it says a one-year memorial, because their one-year memorial is coming up here pretty quick. So this is just really tragic what's going on with our government. And here's another thing. When the Secret Service was here 4 months ago, as they were leaving, one of them turned to my wife, Carol, and said, you know, you have an awfully nice home here to be doing what you're doing. So, you know, these guys, you know, I guess I made a mistake when I told them, hey, we don't see you as the enemy.
Don't you understand that the Secret Service works for the Department of the Treasury?
And you know what is really funny? One of the things I said to them, because they were here for about 3 hours, we were talking. And I said, you know, this idea of a new world order in the United States, we're just not going to go for this. People are just not going to accept this. And they looked at each other and never said a word, you know. And yeah. I thought about that later, and I thought, well, you know, they must think I'm stupid, you know.
Well, they don't take an oath to uphold the Constitution of the United States of America. Were you aware of that?
Well, see, that's what I didn't know at that time, but I have learned that since. So obviously, yeah. They were looking at each other like, you know, this guy is really stupid, you know.
Yeah. See, these people don't work for the United States government or the United States Treasury. They work for the Department of the Treasury, which is an arm of the International Monetary Fund, which is an agency of the United Nations.
See, this is bad.
Lloyd Bentsen actually receives his paycheck from the International Monetary Fund and not from the United States government under the Treaty of Bretton Woods.
Well, you see, this is the type of thing that millions and millions of people have got to learn.
That's right.
Truth about. See, this is the only thing that's going to get people gelled together and organized to stand against them coming door to door and taking our weapons away from us and stopping. See, without our weapons, we have no chance to stand against this.
That's right.
This is really bad what's happening. And I, you know, I've heard these stories about black helicopters before. I kind of halfway take it to heart, and then I go, well, geez, you know, that sounds so outrageous. But, man, when it happens to you, all of a sudden it hits home to you that there is a real serious problem here. You know, I mean, more than serious. You know, this is, this is like a third world nation or something.
Well, the problem is that we are and have been for a long time at war, and most people are so ignorant about their own country that they don't even know it.
This is the problem. That's what I said earlier. We think we're living in a free land and we're free people. It's not true.
That's right. It's not.
And isn't that a shame? I have to say that. And isn't it a shame that we have to fear for our home now? My Lord.
Well, I would advise you, it depends upon what you believe. I believe in God, and I believe that the only thing I have to worry about is whether or not I'm doing the right thing according to what God gave us to follow, his law. And if I'm doing the right thing, then it doesn't matter if I die 10 minutes from now. I'll be okay.
You're right. You're exactly right. And that's exactly the way Carol and I feel. And that's exactly why we take the stand that we do. I just really feel like there was a divine protection here. That's the only thing I can figure out that happened. Because here's another thing, Bill. This is another thing that the detective pointed out that I didn't even realize. He said, Mike, look around the neighborhood here. I said, yeah, you know, all custom homes, because this is a very nice area.
Uh-huh.
And he says, what compares to this home that was hit to your home? And he says, now look, your house and this house that was hit are the only two in the neighborhood that have similar roof lines, except this one is in reverse. All the rest are totally different. And he said, all the rest have fireplaces going up the side of the house. He said, the house that was hit and your house are the only two houses on this street that have a big fireplace coming up through the center of the house and out the center of the roof line. And what else is similar? The house that was hit and our house are the only two fireplaces that have the brick structure, the way the top of the fireplace is put together. The bricks are actually put together in an X formation to make a design around the top of the fireplace. So we're the only two houses on this street that from the air could possibly look similar, alike.
So they deployed their camouflage smoke screen and then got lost in it. These guys seem to be like Keystone Cops, don't they?
Well, yeah.
I mean, they're dangerous. I mean, they're really dangerous. I'm not trying to belittle the danger here, but everything that they've done so far, the Weaver, the Branch Davidians, the Gordon Call up in Whidbey, everything that they've done has been a Keystone Cops episode.
I tell you what, I guess there's a couple of helicopter pilots in real trouble, huh?
The only reason they get away with what they get away with is because most of the American people don't understand what's happening. And they tend to believe the propaganda, and if these people are politically incorrect, regardless of whether they've ever been proven to have committed a crime, then they deserve to die.
You see, this is the problem, isn't it? See, this is exactly what Hitler and Nazism did in Germany by saying, hey, the Jews are abusing their children.
That's right.
They said the same thing.
That's exactly right.
And the German people accepted it.
And you hear it again today. You hear the old things coming back today. All, everything. You go back and study that 10 years from 1930 to 1940, and everything that you heard there, you are hearing here now. Everything that happened there is happening here now.
They're saying the same words.
That's right. And everybody there was expecting a Messiah, and everybody here is expecting Jesus to show up tomorrow morning on the doorstep, and I'm telling you, he ain't coming tomorrow morning.
That's exactly right, Bill, and I keep trying to tell people in the that we're associated with in the Christian community here, stop saying to me that it doesn't make any difference, we're all going to be raptured out of here. I keep telling them, I say, look, you're going to be waiting for the rapture in a concentration camp.
That's right.
You don't stand up and do something about this government.
It's the greatest propaganda ploy, and it's working, and it's neutralizing most of the country who are Christians. Michael, we got to go. Time's run out. I want to thank you for being a wonderful guest, and maybe I'll talk to you. Maybe we can get you back. I'll talk to you through Linda. Maybe we'll get you back on another night.
Okay.
Good night, folks. Make sure that you are ready to praise the Lord and pass the ammunition. Good night, and God bless you all.